name is Belice. Belice Pesty. I don't know where he's from, but it was on Messenger through Facebook, and he said, "Hi, Pastor James, just watched your video on YouTube on Bible Study 101. Found it very useful. Recently had the desire to study the Bible deep, just didn't know how to do it. Thank you. My question is, which book should I start with? Can I just pick a random verses each day? Thanks, Baloo." And I responded and said, "Praise God, Baloo. The Gospel of John is a great place to start your study. Look up the word comprehended in verse 5. In other words, as the Holy Spirit teaches you in Christ, Pastor James." And he said, "Pastor James, looking forward to see and learn more from your next video. Praise God. You're a real blessing. Thank you. Can hardly wait to start my first Bible study. Many thanks, Baloo." So these Bible Study 101 and 2 and the whole series is available on YouTube. If you want to go back and watch it, you can watch it. You can go through and review. And we're going to review a little bit as we get started this afternoon with Bible Study 102, and then we're going to go step just a little bit further and go into the next level of how to study the Bible. So let's pray together. Father, again, we just want to thank you this afternoon for this opportunity to just learn some principles that will help us in how to study the Bible. And as we look at your word, we realize that it's originally written in Hebrew and in Greek, not in English. And sometimes meanings get lost as the translation occurs, not just to the English, but from English into other versions of the Bible. And we want to be able to go back to the original source and compare various verses and see if there are hidden gems that can help us to understand more clearly what your word teaches. So guide us with your spirit this afternoon, Father, as we study together, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so that's what we did last time we were together. We did our Bible Study 101, and we learned that when you read a Bible verse that's translated into English, there may be some words in there that don't translate over into the English language. And we want to be able to learn how to study the Bible for ourselves so that we can go back. You know, the pastor gets up and he says, "Oh, the Greek word for this is such and such, and the Hebrew word for this is such and such, and what it actually means is such and such, and this same word is found over here and it means this." Well, how can we do that as lay people? Well, it's very easy. So we looked at John chapter 21. Do you remember that? And there were three instances here where Simon, who had betrayed Christ, was tested by Jesus. After they had dined, Jesus said to Simon, "Simon Peter, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these?" Remember what Peter had said, "I'll never betray you. They may betray you, but I won't." So Jesus is now testing Simon. "Do you love me more than these?" And what is the word that he uses for love? Anyone remember the first word? Agape. "Do you agape me?" That's what the word means. And so we learned how to look that up. Remember, we went to our Strong's Concordance. Now, that's a hard Strong's Concordance. There's also an app that you can get on your smartphone. If you don't have a smartphone, be sure and get one. Just for this purpose, not for any other purpose, just to be able to study the Bible. And there's an app that I have. It's called the Strong's Concordance. And I learned today in talking with Jay, who has been searching for this app, that the app is $4.99. The one I have is $4.99. There's a light Strong's Concordance app that's free. And there are other Strong's Concordance apps that are free, but the one I have is $4.99. And I think I paid for it because I really liked it and liked the way it worked. So you go to your Strong's Concordance, either a hard copy, which is a hard copy, and if you go to the hard copy, you're going to open it up and you're going to be looking for the word love, lovest, from the King James, love, and it's going to be in alphabetical order. So you start with, just like a dictionary, A to Z, you go through to L. When you get to the L section, you look up the word lovest, and when you get to that word, you look up your verse, where that word is found in your verse, John 21, verse 15. And as you get to that, you're going to find that it's defined, agapeo, as the Greek, the equivalent in English, and then it gives the definition to love in a social and moral sense. And then you go back to your verse and you put it in. So he said unto him, "Lord, thou knowest that I love..." Oh, excuse me. Verse. "Son of Jonas, do you love me? Do you agape me?" That's what you would put in there. Do you agape me? Following so far? You've got your verse. You look it up in the concordance. It's A to Z. You come to the L's. You look up the word love. and you find that verse that it's used in, John 21:15, and then right across from it is going to be, now if you're in your app, it's really easy because you just look up in John chapter 21. Verse 15, and you look up the word, the verse 15, you look at the word love us, and all you do when you get to the word is just push your finger on the word, and it comes, gives you the Strong's definition, gives you the Greek definition. So it's really easy here. In the concordance, it's a little bit more of a challenge, because you've got to go to the page, and then you've got to find the word, and then you've got to find your verse, and then when you find your verse, it takes you to a number, and then you've got to go to the back of the concordance in the Greek dictionary, which is the New Testament, and look at your number, 25, it's in numerical order, so it's 1 all the way to 4,000 or whatever, 5,000, and you look up the number under 25, and it gives you your definition. So, smartphones are convenient because they're fast. Click on it, there it is. Perhaps from, again, much agapeo is what it says here, to love in a social and moral sense. And then it has the colon, and after the colon is the way the word is used. So all you're doing is looking up the word, and you're going back to your verse, you're putting it in. All right, once you do that, you go to your next word. And he said unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. So we looked up the word here that Peter uses in responding to Jesus. He says, you know I love you. Jesus says, do you love me more than that? You know I love you. What is the word here that Peter uses? Yeah, phileo. So you look up this word in the Strong's Concordance, it's a completely different love. It's a completely different word. In the English, we're thinking love is love is love. But like I told my wife yesterday, I love 7-grain bread. It's crusty and I like to cut it and I love it. But I don't love 7-grain bread the same way I love my wife. I better not, right? I better not. And so, in the English, we lose a lot of understanding because we don't have these different words for love. They have it in the Spanish, and they definitely have it in the Greek. They have phileo, they have agape, they have eros, they have different words for love in the Greek. And so when we look up this verse, and we start looking up the word, we find, oh, when Peter responded to Jesus, he didn't say, of course I agape you. He was saying, you're right, Lord, you know that I only phileo you, basically. Do you agape me? No, I phileo you. Do you agape me? No, I phileo you. And then what was the last thing that Jesus asked Peter the third time, when he said it the third time? Said it the second time, do you agape me? Peter says, same thing, same word, agape. Peter says, no, I love thee, I phileo thee, same word, again. And then when Jesus said to him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me, what was the word he used? Do you remember? Anyone? Phileo. He didn't use agape this time. Now, this third time, Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, lovest thou me, phileo. Why was he grieved? Because Peter had already said to him twice, I don't agape you, I phileo you. I don't agape you, I phileo you. Now, Peter said, and then Jesus says, do you even phileo me? And that really grieved Peter's heart. And the reason I think it grieved him is because he was completely aware of his inability at that point to be faithful to what he felt. So he knew when Christ said, do you even phileo me? He was saying, wow, do I even phileo you? Oh man, I don't even phileo you. He's not going to argue with Christ now. He hasn't been arguing with Christ. It seems like he's arguing with Christ when Christ says, do you love me? He says, I love you. Do you love me? He's not. He's actually submitting to Christ. He's saying, do you agape me? No, I phileo you. Do you agape me? No, I phileo you. Well, do you even phileo me? Oh, that grieves me. Lord, you know all things. You know. You know where my heart is. You know. And that's how he responds. So he's a humbled man. Peter is a humbled man. And it's only when you look at the Greek that you really get this, that it really makes sense, that you really understand it. Okay, Lee, you had a question. Hand up.
Not so much a question. I was reading in Acts of the Apostles, and there Mrs. White says that what that actually was it was bringing Peter to the point that where he realized that he couldn't even...
Yes.
Love.
Yeah. Christ. Right. He realized, as we should realize. So, what Lee was saying was he was reading Acts of the Apostles and on the story, the commentary on the story, and it was basically saying in there that this was bringing Peter to the place where he was realizing he couldn't even love, period, without Christ. And phileo love, defined, is usually the natural affection that is present in families. mothers to children, siblings, etc. Agape love is a step beyond that. It's the unconditional love, the kind of love that God has for the world, and that's the kind of love he wants to put in our hearts. Many times we have the phileo love for our families, especially for our kids. It's kind of a natural thing. And so Peter is falling back to that. He's saying, I don't have the agape unconditional love, but I do have the phileo love. And what basically Lee is bringing out here, which I totally agree with because it's what the Bible is teaching, is nope, you don't have that either. Can a woman forget her sucking child that she does not have the compassion on the son of her womb? Can they? Yes, they can. That's phileo. They can even lose phileo love. And that verse would be a good verse to affirm what we're reading here in John. Which, by the way, once you come to the conclusion you come to in your Bible study, then you want to look for verses that would kind of actually firm up what the conclusion that's being brought forth here, so that you broaden your study, it gets larger, and that would be a great verse. Anyone know where that verse is? Isaiah 49, I think it is, or where is that? Can a woman forsake her? Well, someone look it up. Do you know how to look up a verse when you're studying the Bible? Do you know how to look up a verse like that? You'd look up one of the words like, can a woman forsake her suckling? A good word to look up in the verse is one that you know is not going to be repeated a lot of times. Yeah.
Isaiah 49:15.
So you'd add that to this verse, to this section of Scripture. You'd put in your margin of your study or in your Bible or in your notes or whatever, you'd put Isaiah 49:15. And you would write in there, phileo love. You know, and just a little note, phileo love is the natural affection, which also is from God and not natural for us without God's help or whatever. Yvonne.
Jesus asked,
just a second. Can you do the mic?
Did he ask him three times, do you love me? Because Peter denied him three times?
Yes. Yeah, the question is, was Peter asked three times because he was denied Christ three times? Yes. He was tested three times. And the reason for this test, we have to ask ourselves, why did Jesus do this? Because the disciples had probably lost confidence in Peter, and so had Peter lost confidence in himself. And so Christ worked him through this publicly in order to help him regain confidence for ministry. That's why Christ, every time, he closes this and he says what? Let me get to the deal here. Feed my sheep, feed my lambs, feed my sheep. First he says, feed my lambs, and he says, feed my sheep, feed my sheep. So what he's saying? He's saying, do you love me, agape? No, I phileo you. Feed my lambs. Do you love me, agape? No, I phileo you. Feed my sheep. Do you phileo me? Lord, you know all things. You know I phileo you. Feed my sheep. Feed my sheep. Feed my sheep. So Jesus is reinstating him in ministry because Peter is a humbled man. And Peter is acknowledging, oh, I don't agape you, I phileo you. Oh, I don't agape you, I phileo you. Oh, I don't even phileo you. Feed my sheep. And the answer is always, feed my sheep. And remember when we looked up verses. We look for verses in the Bible that would help us understand what do these lambs and sheep represent? Do you remember that? And this is kind of the fun part of Bible study. This is kind of like a little addendum, a little extra, a little supplement. Oh, well, how do we do that? Or what does that mean? Well, it's just an idea. Like, three times he's tested and three times he's told to feed sheep. Are there different types of sheep in the Bible that are described? Well, yeah, there's lambs, which primarily is a word that's used to designate those that are in the church, the Lamb's Book of Life. Then there's sheep, which is a word that's used to designate people that are in other folds. Many other sheep I have that are not of this fold, Jesus said in John chapter 10. Them also must I bring, and they'll hear my voice, and they'll respond. And then there are sheep that aren't in any fold. Oh, we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to our own way, and the Lord has laid on the iniquity of us all. So when Peter is told to feed the lambs and the sheep, he's not told just to feed people that are in the church. He's told to feed people that are also in other denominations, and even people that are just sinners out there in the world. You see? And this is what God is calling us to do as Christians. And why is he calling us to do it? Because you've got one of two options. We can feed, nurture, and strengthen people, or we can criticize them, judge them, and compare them with us. That's what Peter did before. But Jesus said, when you're converted, I want you to strengthen your brethren, to feed your brethren, not to criticize and judge and compare yourself with your brethren. Those are our two options. All right. whenever you study the Bible, you look up these words, you're not just getting a basis of what the text is saying, you're also wanting to bring the practical application of it into your life. So that's what we're doing when we're saying, okay, feeding the sheep, nurturing the sheep, that's one application. What would be another application to this series of Bible verses in relation to Peter that would apply to us? What would be another thing that we get out of this? What do you get out of it? Anyone?
Knowledge, wisdom,
closer
walk. Okay. Knowledge or wisdom.
Okay, knowledge and wisdom, of course, that's going to come out of the Bible. Closer walk with Christ. In what sense do we get a closer walk with Christ? Yeah. So you're talking about the instruction to do that. Nurtures us.
It's a lot easier talking about the criticism. It's a lot easier. You can do that on your own.
Yeah.
You can criticize and put people down on your own.
Yes.
But the only way you can lift people up,
yes,
and share them the love of God is if you have Christ in you.
Yes. It's natural for us to criticize, but the only way we can uplift is when Christ is in us. All right. What else do you get out of this? Anyone else get anything else out of this? Any other thoughts? Yeah, these are the practical aspects. God is calling us to be practical in our Christian experience, to depend on Him, to nurture others, so that we can grow strong. All right. What I'd like to do right now in our 102, that was a review of 101. That's what we looked up, or what we did last time we were together in this, going through this real quick. And by the way, when we end it, when you finish it, you want to go back to your verses and you want to put all of the text in there. I'm skipping through these because we've already done this, we've already videoed this, but I wanted to remind you, so when you're finished with your study, put the words, the Greek words, into your verses. Write them on the side and read the verse. Write it out. Write out the verse with the words in there. When they had dined, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest agape thou me more than these? And he said unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I phileo thee. Okay, so put the words in there so that you can get a feel for how the verse actually reads in the original language. And that's basically what I've done here. Feed my sheep, those who are in other churches. Feed my lambs, those who are in the church. Feed my sheep, those who are in other churches. And again, feed my sheep, those who are in the world. All right, let's go to Bible study 102. I think we talked about these also, and sorry for having to go through each one of these, but we should get to it here. Here we go, Bible study 102. Here's what I'd like to do now. I'd like to just pick and choose a few verses through the Bible, a few ideas, three questions through the Bible that can kind of open up to us some insight into, you know, difficult passages or ideas. And then I'd like to open it up. I'd like you to bring up a verse that you'd like to study or that you have a question about or that you find difficult. Now, that may not happen today, but I'm opening this up for our next two sessions. I have plenty of material to share in the next two sessions together, 103 and 104, but I'd like to open up for you, when you go home today and this week and next week until we come back together, I'd like you to think about verses that maybe you'd like to have a study, that you have questions about or that you'd like us to look up and or maybe it's a verse that you looked up. Maybe it's something that you found and you'd like to bring it and say, hey, you know, I looked up this verse and I found this word and it really helped me to understand the verse, or it really opened my eyes to see something I hadn't seen before, and you'd like to share that with us. And the reason I'm doing that is because I want to encourage us all and the audience that's watching this video that this is really simple, it's really practical, you can do it, it's not difficult, and it's all about just making the applications, learning how to do it. And then also, if you trip up anywhere, you come to a dead end, you're like, yeah, I did what you said, but I didn't get this, or I didn't know what to do next, or I wasn't sure how that happened. If you start doing this, you're going to come against some of these barriers now, and while we still have the classes going on, you'll be able to come back and work it out. All right? So the first question we're going to deal with right now, unless someone has one, does anyone have a verse they want to look up? If anyone did, it would be Tina. I know that for sure. Okay, but you do have one, don't you?
I have one.
Yeah, you do. I know you do. I can tell. Okay.
Spending one.
Okay.
That's what I was trying to get.
All right. So question, is the investigative judgment a biblical teaching? We teach the investigative judgment. We teach, as a church, that we are living in the time when God is investigating his people. There are a lot of churches that don't believe that. They don't believe that God is going to investigate his people. Why would he investigate his people? Why would he judge his own people? Why would he judge Christians? They're saved. They accepted Christ and they're saved. And one of the reasons I always give for the investigative judgment, it's not just about that issue. It's also about the accusations of Satan that Jesus wants to bring to an end. And so Satan is the one that's accusing. God is seeking to silence him, and that's why our lives are open for investigation. But another reason is because there are a lot of people, according to Matthew 7, that claim to be followers of Christ and aren't. They're only professors. And so God has to make that clear also. And then another reason why we have a judgment is because it gets us off the hook. We don't have to judge people anymore. God's in charge. He's judging. So we don't have to judge. You know how we sometimes want to judge people, right? Paul says in Romans 14, we're all going to stand before the judgment seat of Christ, so stop judging one another, you know, anymore. Okay, but is it in the Bible? That's the question. Okay, check this out. This is really interesting. Psalm 26, verse 2. Examine me, O Lord, and prove me, try my reins and my heart. Examine me. Now, I want us to look up that word. Do you have your Strong's Concordance? Do you have your little online Bible? Strong's? I want you to go to Psalm. So what you would do basically for this to work is you go to Psalm chapter 22. Okay? Excuse me, chapter 26. Go to Psalm 26. And I'm hoping that everyone brought with them either their handy-dandy concordance in your smartphone or a hard copy of a concordance. Because to give this class, if I'm giving you this class and you don't have any way of studying, now maybe you didn't bring it with you, but you have it at home. You do? Okay. All right. As long as you've got it. In other words, we need the tools that we're going to be learning to use here. We need those tools either with us or at home so that we can actually practically use what we're learning. All right. Anyone looked up the verse yet? Psalm 26, verse 2. Examine me, O Lord, prove me, and try my reins and my reins and my heart. Anyone there? What you do when you get there is you click on the word examine. Now, I might be arbitrary here, but I've done a lot of research on this, so I'm cutting to the chase. You could look up, judge me, O Lord. Now that's clearly, verse 1, that's clearly God's people, David, for example, asking God to judge him. Saying, God isn't going to judge me, how dare you? Well, David is saying, no, judge me, I want you to judge me. Is there a problem with having God judge us? If we know that God is loving and graceful and merciful, there should be no problem with that. But he's also just, there should be no problem with that. Examine me, O Lord. Okay, so you go to the verse 2, and you just put your finger on the word examine and just click on it. When you do that with your iPhone, it's going to bring you a definition. Now, I'm in my Strong's Concordance, so it's got every word is covered here. So it brings me a definition. Anyone got that definition in their iPhone? They'd like to read it? Carol?
A primitive root.
Detest.
To investigate, examine, prove, tempt, try, or trial.
Okay, we're going to go through that again. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's start again. I want you to read the first two lines all the way to the colon.
Okay. A primitive root to test, generally and figuratively, to investigate.
All right, stop right there. That is the definition of the word.
Okay.
That is the definition of the word. When you get to the colon, the definition ends. After the colon, and then you see that dot dash, that's how the word now is going to be used, translated into the English. So I'm going to go over this with you really slowly here. I've got it up on the top. So you've got examine, that's the word. Your Strong's Concordance is 974, that's the number. It's in the Hebrew. Okay? When you go to the Hebrew, this is what you're going to find. The word means to test or to investigate. All right? Let me just see if I've got the... Then after the dot, dot, dash, we find these words. Examine, prove, tempt, try, or trial. Now, one of those words is used in the King James. You notice that. What does it say in the King James? Examine me, okay? So what they did was they took a Hebrew word, which actually means to test or to investigate. That's what it means in the Hebrew. And they translated that word from the Hebrew, examine. Now, there's nothing wrong with that, because in a courtroom, when someone's investigated, they're also examined. It's, you know, that's a word that they've used. But in some of our minds, we don't make that connection necessarily. So it really helps us to be able to go back to the original Hebrew and look it up. Because after the dot, dot, dash, examine, prove, tempt, try, but there's no investigate there. We as a people believe in the, what we call the investigative judgment. And Psalm 26 is all about that. Judge me, investigate me. It's a biblical concept, but we've lost it because the translation from the Hebrew to the Greek has kind of lost the original word, investigate. It's not there. It's in the newer translations, it's examine, prove, tempt, and try.
Mine actually says investigate under grammar.
Under what?
Under grammar, you know, part of it says primitive root.
Yes.
Generally,
figuratively,
to investigate.
Right. Right. Yes, and this is the point I'm trying to make. So I want to bring this out. Tina says, mine actually says investigate. It does. So does this one, right there. That's the definition. That's the Hebrew definition, to test, to investigate. That's what yours says, right? But those words are found before or after the colon dash in yours.
Yes.
Mine just has different things like pronouns, part of speech, language, description, and then it goes to grammar. And it says best.
Primitive root, to test, especially metals, generally and figuratively to investigate. And okay, so you don't have the cold gotcha. Okay.
I don't have what you're talking about.
You don't have what I have in ours. So Tina's is a little bit different. Her program.
Well, actually, up at the very top, this is the way they have it listed. H974, and then all the rest of this information.
Right.
So.
But they don't separate it out.
Mm-mm.
Good. So this is a good example of something we need to clarify. So Tina's Hebrew lexicon, or is it a?
It's the Strong's Concordance.
Strong's Concordance. Tina's Strong's Concordance does not separate it out the way that ours does. If you go to the directions of the hard copy of the Strong's Concordance, they will tell you in the directions that the first words before the colon are the radical meaning of the Hebrew or Greek word. That's what they mean. And they will tell you in the directions, after the colon dash, those words are how the radical meaning was rendered in the Bible translations.
What do you mean by radical meaning?
The radical, this is what the word means. The word actually means to investigate or to test. That's what it means. That's the radical meaning. Radical means the hardcore meaning of the word. When you take that Hebrew word and you translate it over, this is what it means. But they soften up a little bit, thinking, oh, you know, let's use the word examine. That's a good word to use. Let's use the word tempt. Let's use the word prove. Those are the words we're going to use in the English to translate the radical meaning of this word. But the actual meaning of the word is to investigate or to test. That's what the actual meaning is. And that's where it's really important for us to understand how to use a concordance, because the words before the dot, dot, dash and the words after the dot, dot, dash are different. These are where men have come in, and sometimes they're right in harmony with the original radical meaning, and sometimes they're not. Sometimes they're different. I'll give you one example that's kind of interesting. For me, it was very interesting. Let's just open our Bibles to 1 Timothy chapter 4. This is probably one of the hardest. This was one of the hardest areas for me when I started studying the Bible with Adventists. 1 Timothy chapter 4. My wife will tell you that I am a meat-eating vegetarian, a meat and potatoes vegetarian. I'm not a meat-eating vegetarian because I wouldn't be a vegetarian. I'm a vegetarian, but I'm a meat and potatoes vegetarian. So I do a lot of veggie meat. And the reason for that is because I was raised eating meat, 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 meat. That's all I ate. And so when I first became an Adventist, I remember I was studying with the Adventist church and I wasn't quite there yet. I remember these verses were brought to my attention because I was going to three different churches. I was raised Catholic, going to Calvary Chapel, Pentecostal church, and then studying with the Adventists. 1 Peter chapter 4. beginning with verse 1. Now the Spirit speaks expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry, and commanding to abstain from meats, which God has created to be received with thanksgiving of them which believe and know the truth. For every creature of God is good, and nothing to be received, refused if it be received with thanksgiving, for it's sanctified by the word of God and by prayer. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 5.
You have one in Genesis, don't you? What? About the meat eating?
Oh. Yeah. Find it while we do this. So I read these verses. And can you follow what I'm thinking right now?
Yes.
Doctrines of death, commanded to abstain from meats. Meats. These Adventists are teaching doctrines of devils because they're commanding to abstain from meat. I'm a meat eater, right? So the first thing I do, and I'm learning how to use this song some more, so the first thing I do is I look up, I'm really on it right here, I'm looking up the verse. So let's look up the verse, 1 Timothy chapter 1, 1 Timothy chapter 4, let's just go right to verse 3, 1 Timothy 4, verse 3, all right? And if you look it up, by the way, how many of you have a different version of the Bible than the King James or New King James? Debbie, what does your version of the Bible say?
That's the one I have at home that I'm reading. This one right here, I think it's a King James.
Oh, is it a King James? Okay.
Yeah.
Who has something other than the King James here right now?
NIV.
NIV, right here. Let's get Yvonne to read verse 3.
What is it first?
1 Timothy 4. That's what?
That's the version I have.
You have the NIV, okay.
1 Timothy 4, what?
Verse 3. Verse 3. Verse 3.
They forbid people to marry and order them to abstain from certain foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and who know the truth.
So right away, there's a difference between the King James and the NIV. And this time the NIV got it right. See, some people are really into King James like I am. And they don't realize, we've got to realize, no matter what version we're into, that no Bible version is perfect. Okay? Yes, Yvonne.
And then I know someone real well that has a problem with this text in Genesis 9:3, which is, everything that lives and moves will be food for you.
Yes. Everything that lives and moves will be, yeah.
Just as I gave you green plants.
Yeah.
I don't know how to explain.
Oh, we'll get to it. That's a good, really good question. That's a really good question. We'll get to that. Okay, we'll get to that. Yeah, it's not hard. Because he's talking to Noah there, right? That's Noah?
Yes.
It's after the flood? Okay. Yeah, it won't be hard at all. All right, so right away now, we find a difference between the King James, which translates as meats, right? And the NIV, which translates as food. And my point I made was, NIV got it right this time. Now, how do we know that? Well, all we need to do is go back to our Strong's, and we go to 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 3, and again, we look up our, I don't have it up here, I do have this actually in a Bible study, but I don't have this up here. We look up the word meats, and when we look up the word meats, we get the definition from the base of 977, food, literally or figuratively, especially ceremonial articles, allowed or forbidden by Jewish law, .. meat, victuals. Meat victuals. That's how it was translated, at least in the King James, New King James. It doesn't have the NIV here because this is older translation. So, the point is that the word that's translated meats in 1 Timothy 4:3, King James, is not really the original Greek meaning. The original Greek meaning is food. Food. That's the original Greek meaning. Food. So, when you read that word, you have to say, oh, commanded to abstain from food. Not from meat, like flesh meat, but from food. There are going to be people in the end of time that are going to be commanding, forbidding people to marry, and commanding them to, and the word abstain means to hold themselves off from food, which God created. Now, if you look up the word created, this is an interesting word. This is a really interesting word. You look up the word created, and it's... And the number here is 2936, probably akin to 2932, through the idea of proprietorship by the manufacturer to fabricate, i.e. found, which means to form originally or originally form. Okay? This is through the idea of what did God originally form or fabricate for food? That's the point of this Greek word. So in the latter days, people are going to come and they're going to be commanding people to abstain from the food that God originally formed to be created for eating, that God originally founded or fabricated for eating. They're going to be commanding people to put themselves off from the food that God originally formed. Now, it's really interesting, isn't it, how today we have a very strong push back to a vegetarian diet. Some of us call it the Genesis diet. A lot of New Agers are into it, et cetera, et cetera. But we also have another strong push away from that. And the dairy industry and the meat industry put a lot of money against going back to that diet. And for reasons, for good reasons, for financial reasons especially. So you have a conflict taking place here between the two. And this is exactly what the Bible was predicting. The Bible's saying, hey, in the last days, the Spirit tells us there's going to be people who are going to be saying no. In fact, my wife is dealing with this in her practice because one of the most popular diets today is called the paleo diet. And the paleo diet is a high-protein diet, specific, lots of meat, lots of flesh, and very little carbs, very little, no grains. Grains are death. And so there's a strong push away from the diet God made toward a flesh-eating diet. So when you look at the words here, the meaning of these verses is actually the opposite, if you will, of what you, of how they seem to read when you first read them. And this is where learning the Greek and Hebrew can really help. So the way you would read this is, in the latter days, people will command to forbid to marry and command to hold themselves off from the food that God originally created to be received with thanksgiving of them which believe and know the truth. Well, of those of us which believe and know the truth, what food did God originally create to be received with thanksgiving? Fruits, grains, nuts, a little bit later, vegetables. That's what he originally created.
Did he really do vegetables in the
beginning? A little bit later, I said, vegetables. A little bit. Some people think it was in the beginning. I'm not going to argue with that. Some people say it was added after the fall. I'm not going to argue with that either. Fruits, nuts, grains, vegetables. And then notice what it says, for every creature of God is good and nothing to be refused. And so people say, whoa, see right there, so everything, every creature, that's every, you know, all the animals. No, the context of the verses is telling us every creature, that is every original formation, everything that God originally created is good and nothing to be refused if it be received with thanksgiving, for it is sanctified, set apart by the word of God and by prayer. So we still need to pray over our food, but the only food that God ever sanctified or set apart for eating is the original Genesis diet. The rest was allowed. So we get to Noah, Genesis chapter 9. Noah comes off the ark, and there's no vegetation. There's no fruit trees. Apples are gone. Sorry. There's no mangoes, no, you know, cantaloupe. It's all gone. And so God tells Noah, every living creature, that's what you need to eat. Because Noah already knows, going into the ark, he already knows, I'm not supposed to eat animals, they're not good for you, but now there's nothing left but animals to eat. So every living creature you can eat. But here's the problem. Every living creature. Well, if Noah eats a pig, do you know what's going to happen to the pigs? They're going to be extinct. Why? There's only two. See, you've got to understand the context. If the context of that story is that all the animals went into the ark two by two, then there's going to be some problems with our interpretation of the verse. But if you understand the context that when the animals went in the ark, they didn't go in two by two. That's a misnomer. The clean animals went in by what?
Seven.
By sevens. And the unclean animals went in by twos. And there's a clear teaching in that. There's clear instruction in that. If you eat one of those unclean animals, that makes the rest of them extinct. No more mating, no more duplication, no more unclean animals. So understood when God says you may freely eat of these creatures is the clean animals. It's just an understood. It's a given in the context of chapter 9. And you got to go back to the flood when the animals came in and how God instructed them to go in to get that context. So what we do is we all often read the Bible out of context or read it without understanding the Greek or the Hebrew. Is there a question right here with Lee? You sure? Can you get it?
And four boys, or was it four girls and three boys?
It was seven, so it was actually 14. All right, let's go on.
Yeah.
after the dot, dot, dash are the way the words are translated from the Hebrew or the Greek, depending on which one, you know, you're looking at, which dictionary you look. So you can take them or leave them. Sometimes they're good, sometimes they're not so good, but it's, you want to go to the original Hebrew or the Greek, and that's where you're going to get your primary definition. Afterwards, you can look up each of these words. Now, here's the interesting, here's the next level. Okay, we did 101, now we're going to go to 102. Here's the next level. You can look up these words, like examine, or prove, or tempt, or try. Look up these words. Here's how I found all of the different verses in the Bible that actually use the word investigate. I found one. And when I found one, I looked up the way the word was translated, the Hebrew word was translated in the English, and I looked up, for example, the word examine. I went into my dictionary, into my Strong's, and I looked up examine, and when I cross-referenced to the number, I went to the number. Now, you don't have to do that now. It's really easy to do because in your handy-dandy app, it gives you all the uses right here. I've got six occurrences here. Or, well, that's created. But anyway, let me go back to our Bible verse and I'll illustrate this for you. So we're in Psalm 26, right? We're in verse 2. We've looked up examine, and it gives us the definition. And then it loads up all of the places that that word is used. See all those places? Those are all places where that word is used through the Bible. So let me just quickly, well, let's see, does that do it on my online? It may not. Okay, so when you look up the word examine, you look for the same Hebrew number, which is right there, actually, in that one, and that every place that word is used, the original meaning is investigate, 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 investigate. So you have, I don't know, a dozen or so, give it them. So you cross-reference this with the verses with the same number, and you find other verses. Psalm 17, verse 3, for example. The word they used was proved, which was one of the renderings of the original word. Proved. Thou hast proved my heart. Well, what does that mean? You've investigated my heart. You've investigated my heart. The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. His eyes behold, his eyelids try. That was one of the ways it was rendered. Try. The children of men, the Lord tries the righteous. Psalm 11, 4 and 5. What does that mean? Investigate. It's the same Hebrew word. He investigates. He investigates. He investigates. So here we have a whole denomination that taught the investigative judgment. You know, these people were Bible students. They went back and they studied the Hebrew and they studied the Greek. They were students of the Word of God. They knew what they were talking about. And so we use that word, and then someone comes along 100 years later, and they go through school, and they don't learn anything but what the teachers tell them, and they have the nerve to say, oh, investigative judgment, that's not biblical at all. Actually, it's solid Bible truth. Solid Bible truth. It's right there in the Bible, all through the Bible. The righteous God tries or investigates the hearts and the reins. Psalm 7, verse 9. Psalm 139, 23. Jeremiah 17, verse 10. It's all through the Bible. All through the Bible. Russell.
There's that word again, reins.
Yes.
Can we see what that means?
Sure. So here's the word reins. Where are we? We're in Psalm 7, verse 9. So again, you look up Psalm 7, verse 9. And by the way, this is really, really practical. Because you're like, yeah, the word reins, what does that mean? What is it? So you just quickly look it up. So Psalm 7, verse 9. Oh, let the wickedness of the wicked come to an end, but establish the just, for the righteous God tries the hearts and the reins. Reins. Was that like horse reins? Feminine of 3627, only in the plural. A kidney as an essential organ. Figuratively, the mind. Okay? And the dot, dot, dash, kidneys, reins. So it's the mind. God judges the mind. It's figuratively talking about the brain, where we think, the thinking process, the character, the mind. The reins of the heart, the mind. Okay, any questions about these verses? Did God harden Pharaoh's... Oh, question over here?
Well, I was just going to say that on that Psalms 26, verse 1,
yes.
It starts with vindicate. So I did the same thing with vindicate, and it's pronounced sentence for or against by implication,
yes.
To judge.
Yeah, and the word in the King James is judge.
New King James is vindicate.
New King James is vindicate.
Yeah.
Yep, good.
So it's, again, it's
added.
The Hebrews going, you're going to get judged, you're going to get judged,
yeah.
You're going to get judged.
Yeah. But here's really something really interesting. It's not just you're going to get judged. David is saying, judge me.
Right.
Judge me. He's not saying, you're going to get judged. He's saying, no, judge me. I want to be judged. Why? See, judgment is really good news. And the reason why judgment is good news is because judgment, in our minds, judgment is a negative thing. But in David's mind, when God is judging, it's a positive thing. Because we're being judged all the time by ourselves, by our peers, and by Satan. And it's a negative thing, a critical thing. But when we're being judged by God as believers who trust in Jesus, it's a vindicative thing. The judge wants to vindicate us. The judge wants to protect us. The judge wants to take away our bad record. He wants to cover us with his righteousness. He wants Jesus to step into our place. He wants to silence the accuser. So when God steps into... So David is saying, and he's in bad situations, you know, he's being chased by Saul. He's the guy that's trying to take over the throne, officially, and everyone in the kingdom's being turned against him. He's saying, judge me, O God. Judge my heart. Try my reins. See if there's any wicked way in me. Search me. Please, judge me. Vindicate me. Investigate me. Because he's putting his whole trust in God. And that's what we do. We put our whole trust in God. And we say, yes, we want God to judge and investigate. Because we're going to be judged by everyone else. The world judges. That's just the way it is. And of course, Satan does too. But when God judges, yes, there's sweet victory. There's sweet release there in the judgment of God. Okay. Any other questions about that verse? Let's do one more verse, because we're running out of time. Question, did God harden Pharaoh's heart? Did God harden Pharaoh's heart? It's a question you're going to get asked a lot of times, because it seems to indicate that he did. You know the verse. And the Lord said unto Moses, when thou goest to return into Egypt, see that thou do all those wonders before Pharaoh, which I put in his hand, in thine hand, but I will harden his heart, and he shall not let the people go. Exodus 4:21. I'm going to harden his heart. You do the miracles, I'm going to harden his heart. You do the miracles, I'm going to harden his heart. It's really important to understand how this works biblically. But the first place we begin is with the Greek and Hebrew. In this particular instance, the Hebrew. And by the way, you're never going to be able to, you know, completely doctrinally give a doctrinal assertion based on a Hebrew word or a Greek word or Strong's definition. You understand what I'm saying? Don't base your whole Bible study on this one definition. You begin with that and then you build it from there. We talked about clean and unclean meats. We talked about meats and foods. What do? We went back to Genesis. We looked at the context of the ark and how the animals went in. We look at the big picture. The Hebrew or the Greek simply initiates a broader study of the Bible. A bigger study. And many times what it does is it answers questions in verses that seem to be out of harmony with the rest of the Bible. It helps us to dig in and figure out exactly what these verses are actually saying in their original language. Same with this. The word harden, you look it up, 2388, it means to fasten upon, to seize, to be strong, courageous, cure, help, repair, bind, restrain, conquer. Okay, that's what the word means. God is seeking to cure, to encourage, to repair, to bind, to restrain. He's trying to reach Pharaoh. That's what he's trying to do. He's trying to reach him. But God also knows that when you try to reach someone who cannot be reached, it hardens them. That's what happens. How do we know this? Well, because we simply go and we look in Romans chapter 2, verses 4 and 5, where it says, or despisest thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance? Was God being forbearing and long-suffering with Pharaoh? He brought one plague. Pulled it back, harden. Then he brought another plague, pulled it back, harden. Then he brought another plague, pulled it back, harden. Another. Every single time Pharaoh was softened, okay, I'll let him go, and then he hardened, resisted. Softened and then hardened. He was encouraged to let the people go, but then he resisted and hardened his heart. That was the process he went through. I'm going to harden his heart. How does God know that? Because God knows how Pharaoh is responding, how he's going to respond. He hopes he doesn't. He hopes Nineveh repents. Did Nineveh repent?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Nineveh repented. Wow, yeah, that's great, you know. Did Pharaoh? No. He just got harder and harder. Or do you despise the goodness of the riches of his goodness and forbearance and long-suffering, not knowing that the goodness of God leads thee to repentance? But after thy hardness and impenitent heart are you treasuring up unto thyself wrath against the day of wrath and the righteous revelation of the judgment of God. And it's really interesting. Paul, who just wrote this in Hebrews 2, talks about Pharaoh in Hebrews 9. Talks about Pharaoh himself. So Paul is qualified to clarify what exactly happened with Pharaoh. So what's taking place? When you go back to Exodus 4:21, you find God trying to encourage His goodness is leading to repentance. His goodness is leading to a turning away. Pharaoh turns away, but then he hardens. He turns away, then he hardens. Turns away, then he hardens. And every time he turns away and then hardens, he gets worse and worse and worse until the place where he can't be reached. That's the process that's taking place in Pharaoh's heart. I'm trying to encourage him, but he's resisting. He's encouraged for a bit, and then he turns away, and he gets hard. And by the way, it's really important that we don't do that. We want to follow the light that God gives us, to respond to his goodness, and to walk in that light, and to walk in that light, and not be like Pharaoh, where we respond and then we turn away, respond and then we turn away, respond, because that process can lead us to a place where we harden our hearts. And we don't want to harden our hearts. We want to make sure that our hearts are soft and receptive to God. Question, is the book of Revelation, I said I was going to do one more, but I'm going to finish up here. Is the book of Revelation a closed book or an open book?
Open.
How do you know that?
Because we studied it.
Because it tells us. And we studied it, and we learned. We know what it means. How would you do this just from the title, The Revelation of Jesus Christ?
Reveals Christ.
That's what revelation means. How do you know that?
Revealing.
It means it in the... It means it. That's what the word means. But then you just go to the Strong's. Just look up the Greek word. And if you look up the Greek word, Revelation of Jesus Christ, Revelation 1:1, you find the word revelation is apocalypsis, which means a disclosure, Strong's number 602. It comes from the word apocalypto, which means to take off the cover or to disclose. When you disclose something, when you take off the cover, it's revealing something. So again, very simple way of understanding this word, using your Strong's Concordance, going back to the Greek, and helping people to recognize that, yes, we can disclose, we can uncover the book of Revelation. That's the way it was written. It was written for that purpose. It's not hard. All right. Question, what does the word Pharisee mean? Anyone looked up the word Pharisee? What did the Pharisees do? What was their practice, their religious practice? What's that?
They were lawgivers. They were the legislation of Israel.
Yep. They were the lawgivers. They were the ones that enforced the law. But many times the Pharisees were separating themselves from people, weren't they? Remember that? They would always be in their little group. They didn't want to touch. They didn't want to sit. They didn't want to have anything to do with it. When Christ came along and he reached out and touched sinners and he sat with them and ate with them and he didn't wash his hands before he ate, they would say, oh, you're defiled. Because, you know, we want to be separate from all that stuff. Well, that's really interesting because if you look up the word Pharisee, Luke 15:1-2, the word means 5330, a separatist, exclusively religious, a separatist. That's what they were. They were separationists, separating from every group, every society, everything. They wanted to be. And Jesus came to break that down. So we don't want to be a Pharisee. Remember that song? You ever sing that song? I don't want to be a Pharisee. I don't want to be a Pharisee. I don't want to be a Pharisee. Ba 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 ba. I just want to be a sheep. Ba 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 ba. Praise the Lord, my soul to keep. I just want to be a sheep. All right. Question. Is God's law done away with in the New Testament? Okay. I'm just taking you on a little journey here with different questions that I've asked that have helped me in my study. And so in this one, this last one we'll do together. You look up the word, Romans 3:31, you look up the word void. Do we then make void the law through faith? God forbid, yea, we establish the law. That word, void, do we make void the law? That word right there, if you look it up, is the same word that is used in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 15. In Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 15 it says, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, even the law of commandments contained in ordinances, for to make in himself of twain one new man, so making peace. So Paul says here, do we make void the law? No. Through faith? No. We establish the law. Paul says here that he's abolished in his flesh the law of commandments. Do you see a contradiction there? There is a contradiction there. There is a contradiction. The word void or abolished, it's the same word, 2673 means to render entirely idle or useless. To render entirely idle or useless. Whoops. That's the end of our study. So, Paul, I'm just going to put the word in. Paul is saying in Romans 3:31, do we then make entirely idle or useless the law through faith? God forbid. We establish the law. Then, in Ephesians 2:15, Paul is saying, having made entirely idle or useless in his flesh, the enmity, even the law of commandments. So there has to be a difference between the law he's talking about in Romans 3 and the law he's talking about in Ephesians 2. And there is. And that's where you get clarification. A lot of people are going to come to the conclusion that the law has been abolished, Ephesians 2:15, without reading Romans 3:31, where Paul says we don't abolish the law. And the only way you can get clarification on this, so there's no contradiction, and this is one of the keys to Bible study. If you come to a place in your study, in your conclusion, where there's a contradiction, where one verse says the law is abolished and the other verse says the law is established, you have not understood the subject in hand. There's a misunderstanding, because the Bible doesn't contradict itself. Paul's not contradicting himself. So in Ephesians 2:15, the law of commandments contained in ordinances is the ceremonial law. You'd have to go to the Old Testament, and this is where the study gets interesting. So Tina asked the question, if you were to look up the word ordinances, what would it give you? And it would give you basically connect to ceremony, and we could look it up right now. But the point is that you would have to take, first of all, the context of the chapter. What is he dealing with in the chapter? What is the circumstance? And when you look at the context of the chapter, he's dealing with the circumcision ceremonial laws that were being brought into the Christian church by the Judaizers who were trying to enforce circumcision and the keeping of the ceremonial laws. And Paul was saying, no, these laws contained, the law of commandments contained in ordinances has been nailed to the cross. It was fulfilled in Christ. Now we know he's not doing it over the whole law, because then he says in Romans 3:31, do we make void the law through faith? God forbid, we establish the law. So what law is he talking about there? The moral law.
Someone asked me, how did they know which laws to nail to the cross? Who did that?
Right. Good question.
Yeah.
Someone asked, how do we know which laws were nailed to the cross?
I know why they knew which ones were nailed,
nailed to the cross. How did
the
we know?
Ceremonial ones.
Yeah, how do we know which ones were nailed to the cross? Because we know that the moral law is eternal.
But I mean, did the Jews crucify him? I mean, the Romans know that?
The Romans didn't know that. The Romans just crucified him.
So who nailed those to the cross?
No, no one nailed anything to the cross.
Oh.
Jesus was nailed to the cross. It's figurative.
Oh.
Yeah. He was putting on the cross the law of commandments contained in ordinances because he was the fulfillment of all those ceremonies. So all those ceremonial laws were pointing to the Lamb. They were pointing to all of the different things that had to do with the Messiah. His death, for example, Paul calls him in 1 Corinthians 5, verse 7, the Passover Lamb. Well, the Passover was one of the ceremonial laws. They were supposed to keep the Passover. It was a law. And when the Passover fell on a Tuesday, that was a Sabbath. That was a holy Sabbath day. If it passed on a Thursday, that was a Sabbath. If the Passover fell on a Sabbath, that was a high Sabbath. It was a double Sabbath. It was a seven-day Sabbath and a ceremonial Sabbath.
So when we get to heaven and we keep off his Sabbaths, mm-hmm. is that the seven-day Sabbath
or the ceremonial Sabbath?
It's the seventh day. When we get to heaven and we keep the Sabbaths, it's the seventh-day Sabbath. It's the law, moral law Sabbath. It's not the ceremonial law Sabbaths.
Do you remember
what verse it is or where that verse is where he says they nailed him to the cross? I just read it, but I can't remember where.
Nailed him?
No, nailed them, the laws, to the cross. There is a passage.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember where that is?
Yeah, it's in Ephesians 2, and then it's in Colossians. Let me just... Mm-hmm, this one right here, and then Colossians chapter 2. Verses 14, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was contrary to us, took it out of the way, nailing it to the cross. That's Colossians 2:14. Yeah. And again, notice in Colossians 2:14, the handwriting of ordinances. The handwriting of ordinances. The commandments contained in ordinances. These were the ones that were fulfilled in Christ. And these were the ones that were nailed to the cross. The moral law was never nailed to the cross.
Yeah, he tells us here in our concordance then that the ordinances says the rules and requirements of the laws of Moses, carrying mm-hmm. the suggestion of severity. So you could go there.
That would help.
People.
Yep, that would help.
It doesn't mean the moral law.
Right.
It? Okay.
Right. And you know, in a sense, the moral law was nailed to the cross in this sense. Christ was nailed to the cross. And Christ was the embodiment of the moral law. You see what I'm saying? But not in the sense of doing away, because the idea that the law was nailed to the cross has been in many people's minds, it means that means it was done away with. But when Christ was nailed to the cross, he wasn't nailed to the cross to do away with the law. He was nailed to the cross to pay the penalty of breaking the law. That's why he was nailed to the cross. All right. That's it for now. So the point I want you to get out of this is you got a verse here, you got a verse there. You've got a word here, you've got a word there. That lays the foundation for a bigger study. You look up the word, it really opens it up. Oh, that meat means food. Okay, I got that. Oh, right here, this word means to investigate. And I can actually look this up in its renderings and find other verses that mean the same thing and lay a foundation in these verses for a teaching on this. All the words food right here bring out and are in harmony with God's original diet, what God originally formed and created. Then I go back to Genesis chapter 2 and I outline his original diet, and I go to Genesis chapter 9 and it helps me to answer the question about clean and unclean, etc. So you see, learning how to study the Bible, learning how to use a concordance or look up the Greek and the Hebrew isn't the end of the Bible study, it's just kind of the beginning, it's initiation. We start with that and then it takes us back to the Bible, and it kind of builds on the foundation that many of us already have, or it answers some of the questions, difficult questions, that come up as we're already laying out those verses that we know so well. Does that make sense? Gina?
So would you recommend on this one, I can go and download commentaries right there in the concordance, and there's a whole list of them. Not an Ellen White commentary. Would you recommend downloading those so you kind of get the gist of where all the different verses are?
Yes, commentaries are very helpful.
Okay.
Bible commentary, especially if you're a student of the Bible, you've done some Bible study, you know what the Bible's teaching. I've been blessed by a lot of different commentaries. There's some that are really good.
Geneva
Bible Most would be all right.
Matthew
Henry's are excellent.
Okay.
Now you got to understand, commentaries are commentaries. They're uninspired. They're not inspired. But they can really help. They give insight and open understanding to the Bible from perspectives that, you know, but your bottom line is your Bible study, your Greek and Hebrew, that's where you want to end up when you're giving the study, you know. But you go to Matthew Henry's commentary, you go to the Geneva commentary, you go to Ellen White's commentary, all of these areas are going to really help us. When you go into a Bible study, it's the Bible and the Bible only. That's what you want to be presenting, the Bible and the Bible only.
We can
download. I don't think it's here, but I know there is a commentary, and there's a short version of it. It's not an exhaustive commentary. Matthew Henry's is probably more exhaustive, I would say, in certain areas.
You can't just download a bunch of them because they all cost money.
Oh, they do?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, you'd want to be careful. I would recommend, for example, Matthew Henry's. I don't know that I would recommend the newer ones necessarily. Darby and Scofield, I would not recommend. Totally not recommend. Yeah, okay. What? No, John Calvin might be okay. You know what he teaches, Calvinism, but the guy was a godly man and he had a lot of good stuff, a lot of good insights. But again, these are men's commentaries. They're going to help us, but we want to be into the Bible and the Greek and the Hebrew. That's where our foundation needs to be. Any other questions?
I have a question.
Yvonne.
Somebody asked me the other day when the serpent deceived Eve and God made him crawl on his belly the rest of his life.
Yeah.
Eating dust. In Isaiah 65, when it talks about the new earth, it talks about the lion will eat straw like the ox, but dust will be the serpent's food. Will the snake always be on the ground?
Sounds like it.
He's always
sounds like it.
Was that his punishment forever and eternity?
Sounds like it.
Oh,
he's going to be down here, though.
Yeah, this is the new heaven. No, I mean a real snake.
Yeah, down here, the real earth? I mean, the new earth?
Isaiah 11 says that a child will put his hand in a cobra's den and it will not hurt.
He's not an agent of Satan's at that point.
Oh, no.
Satan will be there.
No.
He's just going to be
serpents are going to be serpents without wings.
Yeah.
They were created with wings, apparently. I can't picture a flying snake. I'm so glad they don't fly. It's bad enough that they crawl, right? Never mind fly. Can you imagine them swooping down on us and taking bites out of us and then taking off? Today, my wife and I were walking back to the house. And we saw a buck come right out in front of, from here to Nancy, come right out. And this buck had a full rack. And I said to my wife, I said, aren't you glad that they're not aggressive? It's not like a bear. It's not like even like a bull. You know, they look at you, and he turned and he looked at us. He's like, people, what should I do? I said, go. Okay. You know, but can you imagine if a buck like, And comes running after us with those antlers lowered. Whew. I'm glad they still have the fear. I'm glad they still have the fear of man in them. But in the new earth, they're not going to hurt and destroy in all my holy mountains. So there's not going to be any fear of snakes or any kind of God's creatures.
They won't be snakes. I'm telling you, they won't be snakes.
Yes. Don't argue with Hannah. When Hannah gets in this mode, just let it go. Just let it go. Okay, Hannah. Not a problem. We're good. It's all going to be good.
There will be no snakes in the street.
Not the way that we see them. By the way, there are certain countries that have no snakes, or certain places that have no snakes. Can you think of one place that has no snakes?
Hawaii.
Hawaii?
There's no snakes.
Hawaii has snakes, don't they?
Who?
Hawaii.
Hawaii? Don't know. I've heard that Hawaii is snake-free, and also, huh? Ireland. Supposedly Ireland.
Ireland.
What's that? Yeah, it wouldn't be there either. Supposedly Ireland has no snakes. They say St. Patrick ran. Anyway, no other questions? All right, let's pray together. Father in heaven, I thank you again for guiding our minds, our hearts, helping us to just get some basics, some understanding of how to study your word. Greek and Hebrew are really helpful, and of course, we need more than that, but they surely open up some key insights into the meaning of the text, and we're thankful that we have the handy software that we have today to help us with that. We also want to be diligent in utilizing the hardware that the books and materials that are accessible to some of us that don't have that software. Just pray that you'll bless each one that's here. Guide them, help them to set up a time to study, a time to look, and help them to be able to remember how to just go back, and whenever they're dealing with a difficult text or a question about the Bible, to go back and be able to study and investigate and open up these verses, Father. We pray and ask these things now, and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, go out and enjoy this.